Good morning, church. Welcome to Oakmont Presbyterian Church as we have gathered for worship and celebration. We hope that you join us in singing and in our prayers as together we worship our powerful God. Let us call ourselves to worship. This is the day that you have made, Lord.
Help us rejoice in it and be glad.
Remind us of the privileges we enjoy as your people.
To come to you in these moments, to confess our sins, to receive forgiveness and give it, to pray and sing and listen, to renew our fainting spirits, to rest in all of your promises.
Open our eyes to see you, Lord.
Open our ears to hear your word.
Visit us through your Holy Spirit.
And help us to celebrate our faith. Amen.
Please join with me in prayer. Let us pray. Lord, again, the time has come to gather as your people, to offer our corporate worship wherever we might be. Bound by the Spirit, serving our Lord Jesus Christ, we come in worship and in praise. May our worship this day be pleasing in your sight. Continue to reveal yourself and reveal yourself in this world. For we pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Would you please join us in our prayer of confession? Holy God, we so often fail to remember how profoundly you love us.
You bless us even when we are not at our best.
You created us and you love us as we are, even as you inspire our desire to be better through your Holy Spirit.
Forgive us when we fail to remember that we are the body of Christ, Saints in process.
God of resurrection life, empower us to begin anew, encouraged by the stories of those who live in your eternal presence.
In the name of Jesus, and for the sake of the gospel, we pray. Amen.
Beloved, we are the children of God. Do not fear the failure that comes with our human nature. Cherish the forgiving grace of God that enables us to learn and grow from our mistakes.
We give thanks that we live in the forgiveness of Jesus Christ, and we rejoice that we may go forward in faith, knowing that God is faithful. Amen. Amen. Would you please join us in asking the Lord to illuminate our hearts as we read his word this morning? Let us pray. Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word is proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen. The Old Testament reading this morning comes from the book of Exodus, chapter 3, starting at verse 1 and ending at verse 15. Moses was keeping the flock of his father-in-law Jethro, the priest of Midian. He led his flock beyond the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. There the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire out of a bush. He looked, and the bush was blazing, yet it was not consumed. Then Moses said, "I must turn aside and look at this great sight and see why the bush is not burned up." When the Lord saw that he had turned aside to see, God called him out of the bush, "Moses, Moses." And he said, "Here I am." Then he said, "Come no closer. Remove the sandals from your feet, for the place on which you are standing is holy ground." He said further, "I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob." And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look at God. Then the Lord said, "I have observed the misery of my people who are in Egypt. I have heard their cry on account of their taskmakers. Instead, I know their suffering, and I have come down to deliver them from the Egyptians and to bring them up out of that land to a good and a broad land, a land flowing with milk and honey, to the country of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites. The cry of the Israelites has now come to me. I have also seen how the Egyptians oppress them. So come, I will send you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt." But Moses said to God, "Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt?" He said, "I will be with you, and this shall be the sign for you that it is I who sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you shall worship God on this mountain." But Moses said to God, "If I come to the Israelites and say to them, 'The God of your ancestors has sent me to you,' and they ask me, 'What is his name?' what shall I say to them?" God said to Moses, "I am who I am." He said further, "Thus you shall say to the Israelites,
I am has sent me to you. God also said to Moses, thus you shall say to the Israelites, the Lord, the God of your ancestors, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob has sent me to you. This is my name forever, and this is my title for all generations. This is the word of the Lord. Amen.
The gospel reading is from the Gospel of John, the first chapter, and then from the 14th chapter, the 7th verse. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and without him not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light, so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. The true light, which enlightens everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world came into being through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to what was his own, and his own people did not accept him. But to all who received him, who believed in his name, he gave power to become children of God, who were born not of blood or the will of flesh or the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory as of a Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. John testified to him and cried out, this was he of whom I said, he who comes after me ranks ahead of me, because he was before me. From his fullness we have all received grace upon grace. The law indeed was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God. It is God, the only Son, who is close to the Father's heart, who has made him known. And from John 14. If you know me, Jesus said, you will know my Father also. From now on, you do know him and have seen him. The word of the Lord. In times of need, in times of fear, in times of confusion, or when I yearn to return to God, I've always been encouraged by the instruction from the letter of James, draw near to God, and God will draw near to you. But who is it that we draw near to? Can we know the one who draws near to us? On July 8, 1741, Jonathan Edwards famously preached the sermon, Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God. Is an angry God the one who draws near to us? To reflect on this question, whether we can really know God, we begin with Moses, the reluctant liberator of the Hebrew people. Imagine Moses tending his father-in-law's flock, when suddenly he sees a bush that is burning but not consumed, and he hears a voice that says to him, come no closer, remove the sandals from your feet, for the place on which you are standing is holy ground. Had Moses stood in the sun too long? Was he dehydrated, perhaps? Or a lonely man with an overly active imagination? We might be tempted to dismiss such an experience, as Scripture tells, but in the Celtic spiritual tradition, such encounters have been described as thin spaces, times or places where the distance between God and humankind is, well, thin, minor. Horeb, the mountain of God where Moses had this encounter with the burning bush, may be described as such a thin space. Furthermore, Moses' later experience confirmed his encounter at the burning bush. God had indeed called him to be the agent of liberation for God's people. Can we really know God? I believe that the answer is yes, for this reason. God has chosen to reveal God's self, to make clear what has been hidden. This is the theological doctrine we call revelation. In calling Moses, the scripture goes into considerable detail. God saw the misery of the people who were in bondage. God heard their cries. God knew their suffering and had come to deliver them, to take them to a land flowing with milk and honey. All that seems like unnecessary information if God could have just commanded Moses to go to Egypt. However, a sensitive reading of the story tells us that something more was going on than just a simple exchange of information. God was revealing God's self to Moses, and now through the scripture, to us. More than the call to go to Pharaoh in Egypt, God's self was revealed. God was known in the encounter. Not known fully or completely, just as we can't know any person fully or completely, but known just the same. And who is that God? From the interaction with Moses, we say that God is the Holy One who was and is attentive, compassionate, and active for the good of God's people. God is not like a sales manager calling a junior associate to go to Cleveland or to Philadelphia to make a sale. God is the Holy One who knows and understands and cares about the people's pain, and God is the one who acts to respond. As we read further into the story, we learn even more about God. After Moses had liberated the people, God gave the commandments to order their lives. Those Ten Commandments tell us about God's intentions for the world and God's desires for humankind. We even learn more about God when the people of God built a golden calf to have something to look upon in their worship. God's angry response tells us that God is not to be trifled with. What we do in our lives before God matters. And like a parent who is angry when their child carelessly runs out into traffic, God's angry response warns us against giving our hearts to matters of secondary importance. Jesus said it memorably to his disciples, "What good is it if a person gains the world but forfeits their soul?" Some preachers have said it in this way, "How many people have climbed the ladder of their desires only to discover that it was leaning against the wrong wall?" Who is it that we draw near to, and who is it that draws near to us? The one who heard the cries of the people, who called and sent Moses to redeem them, the one who gave a sustainable way of life for us and warned against gaining the world and forfeiting our souls. God was also revealed through the prophets. Micah was a prophet from the 8th century before Jesus. With other prophets of the age, he was charged with keeping people alive to God and alert to listening to the voice of God. So the prophet Micah revealed God's character and God's will for us when he asked and answered, "With what shall I come before the Lord and bow myself before God on high? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000 rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? God has told you, O mortal, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you but to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with your God? In revealing what God wanted, we learn what is important for our lives. God is not interested in some superficial connection where we mouth words of faith, but walk only in the ways of the world. God yearns for justice, for kindness, for humility in our ongoing relationship with God. What does Micah's revelation about God say to us for this coming week? A survey of the Old Testament reveals that one of God's characteristics is that God shows up in times of great suffering. Eugene Peterson writes, "Anyone who lives in disruptive times looks for companions who've been through them earlier, wanting to know how they went through it, how they made it, what it was like. In looking for a companion who's lived through catastrophic disruption and survived with grace, biblical people more often than not come upon Jeremiah and receive him as a true, honest, and God-revealing companion for the worst of times." And what did God say through Jeremiah to the people in their catastrophic time? "For surely I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord, plans for your welfare, not for your harm, to give you a future with hope." We can only begin to imagine what an encouragement that was to people who were separated from their families, their communities, and their country. In time, God made good on that promise when Cyrus of Persia issued an edict for the people of Israel to be able to go home. Then through the prophet Isaiah, God promised that a young woman would deliver a son who would sit upon the throne of David forever. We read that promise in Advent and Christmas. "For a child has been born to us, a son given to us. Authority rests upon his shoulders, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace." As God had been revealing the divine self to Israel, God's revelation culminated in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus. John ends his beautiful prologue of his gospel with this message: "No one has ever seen God. It is God, the only Son, who is close to the Father's heart, who has made him known." The letter to the Hebrews says it in a slightly different way. "Long ago, God spoke to our ancestors in many and various ways by the prophets, but in these last days, he has spoken to us by a Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, through whom he also created the worlds." During Jesus' intimate time of the Last Supper, before he was arrested and crucified, Jesus said to them, "If you know me, you will know my Father also. From now on, you do know him and have seen him." In one of my seminary New Testament classes, I remember the professor saying to us, "If you want to know what God looks like, look at Jesus." What becomes clear in the Gospel of John is that God not only revealed the divine self in acts of history through the prophets, God also desired so to be made known that at the right time, God came into the world in Jesus. We know God most fully through the culminating revelation in Jesus. When we experience the grandeur of God in a sunset, we would call that general revelation, what we can generally infer about God from what we see in creation. What we see in Jesus is called special revelation, how God has actively been revealed in the life and death and resurrection of Jesus. In the final hymn today, we see references to general revelation in the first two stanzas and to special revelation in the third stanza. Because the Bible is a witness to Jesus, the Bible is a primary way that God is revealed to us. But God may reveal the divine self through the comment of a friend as well. What we remember from the name God gave to Moses, I am who I am, or I will be who I will be, is that God's freedom enables God to speak to Moses in a burning bush, or to you and me, possibly, through a friend who says, God cares, and so do I. At a Catholic retreat house where a group of Pennsylvania Protestants were gathering, the nun leading our retreat had us pair off and sit in chairs facing each other at a comfortable distance, clearly a pre-COVID exercise. The nun asked us to share with the other person those things that were troubling us or those things that made us feel anxious. Our partner's role was simply to listen, and when we stopped, to pause and then to say, take it lightly. Some 35 years later, that exercise remains a God-revealed message for me. Don't be overly troubled by your troubles. As a pastor, I've said that, don't take it lightly to you, because God is present, God cares, God will make a way. Can we really know God? Yes, because God wants to be known. So throughout our history, and even today, God reveals God's self so that we may love and serve the Holy One who loves us and who has acted to save us. Amen.
Thank you.
Wherever you are, I invite you to stand and join in affirming our faith. In life and in death, we belong to God through the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit. We trust in one triune God, the Holy One of Israel, whom alone we worship and serve. We trust in Jesus Christ, fully human, fully God. God raised this Jesus from the dead, vindicating his sinless life, breaking the power of sin and evil, delivering us from death to life eternal. We trust in God, whom Jesus called Abba, Father. In sovereign love, God created the world good and makes everyone equally in God's image, male and female, of every race and people, to live as one community. Loving us still, God makes us heirs with Christ of the covenant. We trust in the Holy Spirit, everywhere the giver and renewer of life. In gratitude to God, empowered by the Spirit, we strive to serve Christ in our daily tasks and to live holy and joyful lives, even as we watch for God's new heaven and new earth, praying, "Come, Lord Jesus." Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Amen.
We are gathered together in worship. Let us gather together in prayer. As we approach God's throne of grace, let us all pray. God of all life and each life, each week our prayers combine with those of people in many different places, gathered in homes, in dorm rooms, in hospitals. We face many challenges and also a common challenge, responding to the pandemic and living in these unsettled times. Lord, we thank you for honoring all of our prayers with the gift of your Spirit, so that we can find strength and wisdom we need in you. Lord, we remember before you today people living face to face with war and violence in those places where hatred has been stirred up and fear stalks people on their own streets. We especially remember today our own country during this change of power and these unsettling times. God, speak to us a word of peace. We remember before you today people living face to face with so much economic uncertainty, for those who've lost jobs or worried what may happen as this year unfolds. God, speak to us a word of reassurance. We remember before you today people living face to face with discrimination and social prejudice, for those who are bullied at work, at home, for those who are made ashamed of who they are. God, speak to us a word of dignity. We remember before you today people living face to face with illness and suffering, for those struggling with disabilities made even more complex in these days, for those who know grief and anxiety, especially cutting off folks who are cut off from family and friends. We pray for those dying alone. God, speak to us a word of healing. We remember before you today people divided by so many perceived differences of race or creed or culture or gender or generation, and we pray for all who seek to build bridges of understanding and cooperation across all these differences, uniting us as children of God. God, speak to us a word of reconciliation. And we remember before you today your whole creation and its many vulnerable facets and faces. Teach us how to care for the rips and tears in the fabric of life, of the world that you love, that we may live together wisely and peacefully. God, speak to us a word of wisdom. And so, joining our voices to Jesus' followers around the world, we pray the words he taught us: Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
My soul, my Savior God, to thee.
Throughout Scripture, we see how God has been determined to be revealed to humankind. First in Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, then Moses and the prophets, and most fully, completely in Jesus' life, death, and resurrection. Knowing how God so wants to be known by God's people, it means that we can approach Scripture differently, not as a duty to be endured to study, not as a book of facts that we need to master, but as an opportunity to get to know the God who wants to be known by his people. Throughout the book of Proverbs, we read, "The Lord wants weights and measures to be honest, and every sale to be fair." How often I've read that as a duty to be followed by myself. But thinking about God's interest to be revealed, it says to me that God has a heart for those who would otherwise be on the end of a raw deal. As you read Scripture, ask yourself the question, what does God want me to know about God's self? The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all now and forever. Amen.